Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Detour Live. It's the second rest day at the Tour of Spain. I'm tipping iffy. The riders and staff are going to need it because I was talking to the sheriff on WhatsApp and it was a monster transfer last night. And I used to hate those long transfers. Even with the jelly bean game, even with the iPad, they just cook you. And the rest day, particularly the second one, is one that you spend the whole day sleeping.
I can just imagine. Well, you know what? They had, I heard one of the guys saying they had an hour and a half transfer to the start and then 200K in the bike race and then 4 hour transfer last night. All the teams didn't get to their accommodation until 11 o'clock last night. That's terrible.
Yeah. And a lot of the teams have to, you know, have the masseurs on the bus, have to set like a triage sort of table at the back of the bus to do massages. And just, yeah, that's the real point of the race where you're going, geez, I'm not really enjoying this. Anyway, we've got a massive show. We're going to speak to Chloe Hosking, who's got a remarkable story coming back from having COVID last June and then winning a stage at the last stage in Norway. And also Matt Keenan, commentator extraordinaire. And we're obviously going to unpack all the action from the first couple of weeks of Tour of Spain. But we've got Chloe in the waiting room, Iffy. And what can you say about Chloe before we bring her on?
Well, she's the reigning Bay Crits champion.
Oh, I knew you'd open with that.
She's a twice winner of the Bay Crits. Oh, look, yep. She's a superstar, as we know. Commonwealth Games road champion and one of the world's great road sprinters. And she's got a really interesting story to tell. So let's get her on.
Well, I think she's still getting stuff right. Ah, there she is. Can you hear us, Chloe?
Hey guys, I can hear you. I'm very unorganized this morning, and my husband's on a work meeting, so you might hear him.
That's fine. I just saw the camera going everywhere, and I thought, oh, geez, I don't want to bring you in if we're just staring at the mirror and you're getting other affairs in order. So
I thought I'd get my headphones and hopefully block him out.
Well, unlike most guests, your audio is crisp, so that move to get the headphones
excellent.
Was very excellent. Good. I really appreciate it. How you feeling? Yep.
I'll be honest, I'm a bit bruised and battered, but I just need a few days recovery. I took a really huge fall in the fourth stage of the CIMAC ladies tour that I was just racing. So it was with like 4K to go and literally only six.
Here we got it.
Six girls got through and I must have been one of the third or fourth person to come down. And, you know, at that speed. Yeah, you kind of embrace for impact. You just bang on the ground. So, but I'm fine.
Well, yeah, the one thing that's been happening in the last 12 months, 18 months, is the ladies have been starting to outshine the guys in lots of ways. But I didn't want you to outshine this way because the blokes have had a couple of big smashes this year, Tour de France, and you've outdone them again in this one.
Yeah, it's... I was actually in the middle of the race and thinking, wow, these are the same roads that we've raced on for the last, you know, 10 years. I've been doing this for a long time, but the roads haven't changed, but the speed that we race at has. And, you start to think, like, it's pretty crazy what we're doing, actually.
So we mentioned at the top of the show, I was going to say you had a fantastic victory with your comeback. Can you take us through what actually happened last year, you know, contracting COVID?
Not last year, mate. It was this year.
Yeah.
Year. Oh, geez. Yeah, this year. Yeah.
Well, now it's my turn for bad research, John. take us through that battle.
So I was, did my whole preseason, came to Europe. Leaving Australia felt pretty stupid, to be honest, because, you know, at that point in time, Australia was like, you know, the golden standard. And then, so then you come over to Europe where it was not the golden standard. And I met up with my Trek Segafredo team, started the spring, of course, like, you know, it was a new team. So I felt like, okay, I've got to get some runs on the board early. And then literally we had like a burst of our team bubble and a lot of people started testing positive for COVID and I was one of them. So, which was bad enough, you know, get the phone call from the team doctor, Chloe, you've tested positive for COVID. And I was like, ah, shit. So, and then, but, you know, you see around you, people are testing positive and are back racing in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever. So you're like, okay, that's best case scenario. That's what's going to happen to me. And that was not what happened to me. So I started the return to training protocol and was doing some tests. But like my blood values kept coming back bad. The troponin, or I don't know how to pronounce it properly, but the value that relates to the muscle of the heart kept coming back bad. And so then I had to get an MRI and we found out that I had like an inflammation of the sac that protects the heart. And so the specialist said, yeah, in a normal person, we would say 3 months, no exercise. So I'm sitting in there and I'm like, oh my God, like that's my profession. Like what I do is exercise. So that was a big sort of, I just had to process it. And then it's compounded by the fact that, you know, we can't really get home, you know, in a normal situation. Well, I wouldn't have had the inflammation because I wouldn't have caught COVID, but I would have been able to go home, be with my family, be in that supportive environment, you know, have access to all the medical support that Cycling Australia would provide. But no, I was in Europe and I was stuck in Europe. So had to deal with that. And like, it was really 2 months of really not much. So I was probably just riding my bike, but like max 2 hours really. And so I got pretty unfit. And then I was able to start training again, bringing a bit more intensity in. And that was the beginning of July. And I had my first race back, which was the Ladies Tour of Norway, the 12th of August. So, but even then, like, I had a few more stop starts. I had my final medical check, which what I thought was going to be my final medical check, still showed that I had some inflammation around the heart. And so the cardiologist was like, I can't give you the green light to start racing. So then I had to go back another 2 weeks later and do some more testing. And I ended up doing like a Zwift race where, and they were like, the whole time I had like all these wires connected to me and they were like monitoring my heart the whole time. And I hate Zwift races. So maybe that was the worst part of the whole experience, having to do a Zwift race to get the tick of approval. So, but yeah, for 48 hours, they like monitored my heart and then I was finally given the green light. So yeah, I started back at Norway, and to be honest, I had like no expectations. And if I had any expectations, it was that I was going to be dropped out the back every day by myself. But I was, yeah, pleasantly surprised with how I came back. And then I finished with the last stage. I won, which was not like in the plan at all. You know, I was using Norway as preparation for the races coming later in the season and just to get back into the swing of racing. But yeah, this sprint that I won, it was totally suited to me. You know, you have to be quite smart, and it's a lot more tactics than actually speed. And I nailed my tactics that day. So yeah.
Sensational. Yeah.
You've had so many victories throughout your career. Does that one sit right near the top?
Yeah, I mean, it definitely does, just because of the whole backstory, you know. Mm. And there were really points where I was like, should I just go home? Like, should I call the season over? And then to the other side, it was like, am I going to recover? You know, there's so much uncertainty around COVID. And really, when it all started kicking off, I was really scared to catch it. And because you have heard stories that it's been career ending, and I'm not ready for my career to be over. So
neither are we. We're not ready. No.
So to come back and already be, you know, right in the mix at the world tour level, it's really special and also reassuring to know that, okay, I'm still at this level. I can still compete at this level, and I can still win at this level.
I was reading one of the websites on your story, and I could feel your frustration while I was reading the story, because you never got that sick yet to go to the hospital or anything, but there you were, you know, not being able to train, as you say, not being able to be with your family or anything. I could just feel your frustration, but you're a tough nut. I knew you'd get through it.
I think also what was really hard was, you know, if you crash and you broke your collarbone or you break your arm or something, like, you go to your physio and you have your process, your exercises that you do, and you can see the progress of your injury improving. But I was injured, but I couldn't see it and I couldn't feel it. And I was just being told I had to slow down. And if you ask my parents, I've never been good at slowing down. So it was tough. And, yeah, not being able to see the progress, it really it took a lot of, like, yeah, it was mentally super hard, really.
Well, Chloe, I was pretty embarrassed about my terrible research earlier, so I've had to bring in the big guns. And here's a man who's an encyclopedia with dates. He doesn't make any mistakes. That's, of course, Matthew Keenan.
I thought you were going to say Wikipedia, but he's almost as good as Wikipedia.
He's better. He's better.
No, Wikipedia is like Dan. They make mistakes.
Okay. Well, very good. I was just listening to that last bit of that, Chloe. I can imagine you when you were told, Chloe, you need to rest. Your response would have been, okay, how many reps is that?
Yeah, no, really, it was. And I asked my doctor, so what can I actually do? You know, it's like, ah. But, yeah, I didn't have to totally rest. I could do some things, but it wasn't the type of training that you need to be doing to be at the level, you know, that is the world tour these days. So, yeah, it was just had to make a plan.
I think a lot of people from the outside, they look at athletes and they think, oh, is that athlete under training? That athlete's not doing enough. When the reality is that most elite athletes, they probably make the mistake of overtraining, particularly endurance athletes, whether it be triathletes, cyclists, or middle distance runners and marathon runners.
Is there a question?
No, just it's like a general statement for ongoing conversation. Would you agree or not?
Yeah, no, I wouldn't. I know it like I read a quote from Peter Sagan a couple of years ago, and he said the most important session is the session, like, if you do one too many, you know, it's better to do one too few than one too many. And so if I look at it in the scheme of, yeah.
John, 10 too few is not the right answer, though.
Yeah.
Chloe, we talk on this show a lot, particularly that, you know, most of Australia is in lockdown at the moment, and it's all about, you know, mental resilience and processes. Like, what did you do when you dealt with, you know, this massive setback? What was the mental process to move forward, you know?
I think actually what a lot of people probably don't do is let yourself feel sorry for yourself. Mm-hmm. Like, I was in a super shit situation, and I did let myself just be like, well, Chloe, this really sucks, and sort of process that for a while. And then I moved forward to be like, okay, what can I do? What can I control? And also then focusing on, so those little things that I could control, and then also what makes me happy. So because, you know, especially as a professional athlete, there's the idea of what you have to do to be a professional athlete, but that's not sustainable. And it's especially not sustainable when you've got all these other things being thrown at you. So I was doing what I could do training wise, but then I was also making sure that I was doing things that I enjoyed. So simple things like watching a movie, or I was fortunate because I ended up doing a lot of my sort of downtime in Denmark, and they were pretty open, so I could go to the cinema, or like making sure I was in really regular contact with my family, and also like not being afraid to like call my sister and be like, I'm having a really shit day, like, and so yeah, just being open to people and speaking, I would say is what got me through that time.
It's great response.
Oh, it's awesome. I think that lack of control has been one of the hardest things for everybody going through the COVID period. Is you're accustomed to at least having control over what you can do, and that lack of control, it, for somebody in a really privileged position, I've still been able to work, and sure, we're doing homeschooling and so on, and I'm in a great position relative to most other people, but it's that lack of control that's really challenging.
But even the process to get to Norway wasn't easy for you. Like, if you were saying off air, like, it was a 12-hour process just to get to the bloody race.
It's normally like travel days you dread, but I was actually just so excited to be going to a race. Like, it was the first time in really a long time that I like documented my travel day. Like, I was taking photos of my bags on the train, and yeah, it was a really long day. I could have been halfway to Australia. But I was really just so happy to be back racing. And yeah, even crashing in Holland in Simac Tour just the other day, I was still took a lot of, I got a lot of energy from being around my teammates. And to be honest, a nightmare travel day is not enough to dampen my spirits right now.
That's right. Sounds good. I was going to ask Chloe, what's the program now? I see you're still looking at riding the world. So what's the program for the next few weeks?
Yeah, no, I actually have a really good race program until the end of the year. And that was something that really helped me stay focused and to know that there were a lot of races coming up that did suit me if I could get back. So in a week's time, I start a tour in France, which is a 7-day stage race called Ardèche. There'll be some hilly days, but there's also some good stage win opportunities there. So I'm going some stage hunt winning or stage win hunting or whatever.
I like that.
I won a stage there last year, so for sure that's on my radar. And then I do a 1-day race that I won in France just a few days before the World Championships, and I did get the call up for the Worlds. So, of course, I'm really pleased with that, with the course being what it is. It's probably the most Chloe-friendly course for me that's been the last couple of years. So I'm not going in with any expectations, just enjoy it, which is really my goal for the rest of this year because of what has been, a unique year. And actually, Matt, like, I spoke with you in the middle of my whole saga, and you said, oh, that's a whole season gone. And I said, no, it's not.
You said what?
Don't tell me that. I've still got opportunities.
You have. You have. And the Worlds do suit you. Talk us through it. What have you made? Have you had a chance to look at the course, and what are your expectations?
Actually went to ride the course when I was still trying to figure out what was going on with my heart. So I took myself to Leuven and I went and rode the course. And of course, it's not super easy. Like, there's climbs, they're super punchy. It's going to be a lot about positioning. But it's a Flemish style, Belgium style race. So it's so much about luck. It's so much about making your own luck. And I'm good at that. So I'm just going to go in and, see what I can do.
Okay, firstly, Chloe, in my defence, when we had that conversation, you'd been in Copenhagen with COVID. You're backpedaling, correct? You had heart issues. You'd hardly ridden your bike for 2 or 3 months. For a normal person, it was season over, but you're not normal. That's the difference.
I am. I am resilient, and I it's something that I think I've really built up throughout my career. I've had a lot of knockbacks, and I've been told no a lot of times, and I've just always been like, you know what? I'm going to prove you wrong. So
yeah, I love it. I love that. And what about Paris-Roubaix? Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a reserve for that. And obviously I've got a lot of work to do to work my way back into the team. So when the race was scheduled for April, I think it was, I was in the team. So, but a lot happened. And so now I've been put back as reserve. And I don't know if you know this, but I'm on a team that has very good riders.
I know. I've got a fair idea.
So I've got to work my way back in. And that's fine. You know, I rise to challenges. And for sure, I would love to do Roubaix, but if it doesn't happen this year, as long as it happens at some point in my career, it's fine.
Well, I've got an easy solution, Chloe.
Tell me.
They couldn't leave the world champion off their team.
Exactly. Yes. Good point.
Win the worlds.
Done.
Easy. I can feel an eerie similarity to the story of like Matt Heyman when he had that injury before Roubaix, and he used to sort of, I'm not saying that you always overcook things and think it, but he went into that race so mentally relaxed because, yeah, it was like a bonus, a lot of this fear,
yeah,
because it's like you got nothing to lose. And that mentality that you've got, that is such an edge on your competitors because they've been through a whole year. They're thinking about totally different stuff. Your head is clear. So,
yeah,
geez, I think that's lining up.
And I can feel it in the peloton. Like, these girls have been racing full gas since the last weekend of February. And so they're tired. They're mentally tired. But I'm still super motivated. So I do feel like I do have that advantage and I'm going to milk it for all it's worth.
I've got a question from Andy Matthews. He says, hi, guys. Chloe's win in Norway was so great to watch. Do you have vision of the post-race interview? It was one of the best I've seen. Now, I saw that on the Macca's podcast. We don't have it lined up. And you are known for some cracking post-race interviews. I remember sitting over watching the one at the Cobb Games when you dropped. Did you drop the F-bomb? You dropped something, but I remember going, yeah, that was fantastic.
She opened up with the F-bomb.
I thought, that is just classic. And then, you know, sorry, viewers, a technical glitch there. Can you remember what you said after the finish line?
Well, it won't be very authentic now, will it? Nah. I sort of talked through what it meant to me, and I was like really proud of myself for getting through the shitty periods and then coming out with a win. And I think it's really important to like sit back and be like, well done you know. And then I just talked about being for Australians right now in particular, how it can be quite isolating over here. And how I had a lot of good support from my team. Like, there was really no pressure through my whole recovery process or expectations for me to come back and win. You know, they were just happy for me to come back and race. So that I was really grateful that they hadn't piled that pressure on top, because that would have been a lot. I talked through the sprint at the end, how like my thinking process, and because I am someone who really goes into a sprint with a plan. I look at the finish, I rewatch if the race has been there before, I watch how other people have won it. I'll look at Google Earth and I'll go in with a really clear plan. And I did that on the fourth stage in Norway, and I won.
You make a very good DS when you retire, Chloe.
I don't know if that's on my cards.
All the racing stuff aside, though, Chloe, what made the interview was the human element of it. Everybody can relate to the human side of it, the isolation from your family, the support network that you have around you. And Dan, that was the key of the interview. And that's what rattled David McKenzie. When David McKenzie with Christophe Mallet, when they played that interview, and he was watching it for the second time, it wasn't the first time for Macca watching it, he was actually tearing up. He was choking back the tears. He felt your emotion, because he's been in that similar position where he's come back from horrific crashes and injuries, and he's been on the other side of the world at a time in the 90s where the world was a lot bigger. You couldn't talk to your family on FaceTime, and he was writing letters home. And it was something that really resonated with him and struck a massive chord with him. And I asked him about it then, 3 hours later in commentary, and he couldn't talk. He was still riding your wave of emotion, the way you spoke about your family and that support. It was absolutely beautiful, Chloe.
Yeah, no, and I really appreciate the support from everyone back home, like that that resonated with them. And for me, to be able to share what we're experiencing is really special. And for people to understand is also, because I don't know, it's nice sharing things with Aussies. It's special.
And also, it makes people realize that you're not robots, like you're people.
No.
Similar emotions, you know.
I've been watching a few of the interviews from the Paralympics, and there's been a few F-bombs dropped, and I'm loving it. I think we should normalize dropping the F-bomb in interviews.
Well, just be careful on the detour. We can get away with the odd shit, but I think if we start we start really dropping a few bombs, Iffy, I think you'll be starting to sweat, mate. Samantha's got a question for you. She says, is the women's Paris-Roubaix the same course as the men's, Chloe?
So we do the final 116 kilometers of the men's race. So it's exactly the same. Mm-hmm. I think we do 16 or 17 sections of cobbles. And it's like 40% of our race, I think, or more. So it's a lot of cobbles. And I've done the recon. And it's brutal. It's just okay, maybe one section is fine, two section is fine, but once you get to the end, it's just your legs are sapped of energy. And that was in training. So it's you understand why they call it the Hell of the North.
I rode 100 meters of the Arenberg Forest and I couldn't walk for a week.
I mean, I was in lockdown when the actual Roubaix day was meant to be, or I was in quarantine, to be honest. And so I was like, you know what, I'm going to watch from start to finish a Roubaix. So I think I watched the 2003 edition, or the one that Backstead won. And I watched the Arenberg Forest and I was like, this is epic. Like Rolf Aldag hit the start of the forest full gas, and then by a third of the way through he was like standing still, motorbikes were falling over. Oh my god. It was crazy. But we don't do the forest, we don't do the Arenberg Forest.
Oh,
2004.
There
sorry
you go.
Of course,
That's why he's here.
That's right,
exactly.
Keep us. Roger Hammond finished third, and he rode the Sun Tour a couple of times. If you'd remember, and he was the Junior World Cyclocross Champion in 1990. Roger Hammond, and Maggie's daughters are pretty good too, aren't they, Chloe?
Yeah, well, Eleanor's on my team actually, so she's for sure a big talent. Really good time trialist. She's still like finding her feet in the road racing, but she's also young. So, and we don't have that under 23 category. So it's a big step for the young girls to jump straight into the elite.
Mm. Yeah. Well, Chloe, it's been fantastic having you on the detour and the insights, and it's great to see you back. And as I said, that mentality going into the worlds, you got the edge, Iffy, before we let Chloe go.
Just, you're coming back this summer, and are you going to ride the Bay Crits?
The Bay Crits. Question was coming.
I wish. And honestly, I was on the list for this year, but I don't think I'm going to make it back this summer. My husband's actually moved to Europe, so we're relocating here, and it's just too hard, I think. Yeah. So I'm going to try and suffer through my first European winter and see how it goes.
Bummer.
It's been fantastic having you on the show, Chloe. We'll check in again soon after you get the rainbow bands. No pressure.
Awesome, Chloe. Hey, thanks for proving me wrong. Sensational, Chloe. Love the win in Norway. Can't wait to watch the rest of the season. Absolutely magnificent.
Thanks, guys. This was fun. I had no idea what I was getting myself into. I just had John messaging me and he's like, Chloe, we'd love to have you on. And I felt so much pressure. And I'm like, okay.
There's no pressure here, I can tell you.
No, bro. It was fantastic. Thanks, Chloe.
See you guys.
Bye. Bye.
Chloe Hoss's fantastic story. Look, we'll take a quick drinks break. Can you hang around for a little bit longer, Keenan? We'll have a quick unpacking of what's happened in the Vuelta the last couple of weeks, a couple of big stories overnight. So let's have a quick drinks break and we'll be back with more Vuelta after this.
Look at this bike. You think it's just a bike, right? But it's not. It's a bike. 374 people are looking at. This guy, this girl, them, all looking at it. People from here, there, and wherever this is. People that are looking for a bike. Or just a piece of it. Amateurs, semi-amateurs, and pro-amateurs. This guy wants this bike, but with this crank and these bars. This could be the perfect match, but not this one. This girl has a bike to sell, and thousands of people might purchase it. Eyes on Bikes help grow small businesses. His, hers, yours, and the latest data and insights help those businesses keep moving. We are the world's number one bike marketplace, with over 500,000 products and 900 brands, where buyers and sellers are brought together in a place where a bike is never just a bike. Bike Exchange, where the world buys, sells, learns, and rides.
Life is like a two-way street. It's about consideration and mutual respect. Roads are much the same. However you get around, walk, ride, or drive, if we share our roads, we can all be safer. The Amy Gillett Foundation is Australia's peak cycling safety charity. Our mission is for safe cycling in Australia. Our vision is for zero cyclist deaths. Over the last year, we've seen an enormous increase in people taking up cycling, whether it be for recreation, with the family, commuting, or even to start your own cycling career. We need to do more to make it safer for every cyclist. 20 cyclists every day are hospitalized, and one cyclist is killed every 10 days on Australian roads. So, the next time you jump on your bike or hop in your car, remember to practice the four C's. Be courteous, calm, considerate, and conscientious. Every cyclist death is preventable, and we all deserve to get home safely. Please donate to help the Amy Gillett Foundation make the road safer for you and for me.
Thanks again to Bike Exchange, and some great messages there from the Amy Gillett Foundation. Now, let's get back to the Vuelta lads, and we've got to pay credit to Rafał Majka straight off the bat. I mean, Keenan, what a ride.
That was super. So he was with Fabio Aru with about 125 kilometres to go. Figured at 87 k's to go, he'd ditch him. He rode solo, and there was a point on the penultimate climb where Stephen Kruiswijk attacked the remnants of the main breakaway group. And at the start of the climb, a 20-kilometer climb, it was 2 minutes and 20 seconds. Kruiswijk got within a minute and 30 seconds. And then Rafał Majka started dragging it back out the other way and sent it back to about the 140 mark, and then was celebrating with 3 or 4 k's to go. It was absolutely fantastic. And then the interview afterwards, we spoke just with Chloe a couple of moments ago about the support network around her, mum and dad at home, the element, that the role that they play, even though they're on the other side of the world. And Rafa Majka last night, he was kissing and blowing up to the sky because his dad passed away earlier on this year. And he got pretty emotional, understandably, when he spoke about his dad and his kids watching. And it was beautiful to see him let the guard down.
And 4 years since he'd won a stage, we happened to be in the Vuelta 4 years ago, which really surprised me. But the one thing I didn't realise, and you, of course, font of all knowledge, mentioned it last night, was that Kruiswijk hasn't won at World Tour.
I couldn't believe that.
He hasn't won a Grand Tour stage. He's won one World Tour level race 10 years ago, won a stage of the Tour Suisse. Unbelievable. So the guy has finished fourth at the Vuelta, fourth at the Giro, should have won that Giro if he didn't crash in with one small mistake on the left-hand turn. He's been third at the Tour de France. So this guy has finished third place at the Tour de France and has not won a stage in a Grand Tour, and he's won two professional bike races. So Iffy, what does that tell you about how good Michael Storr is when he's won two stages of this Vuelta?
Oh, well, look, the Aussies have just been great, haven't they? You've got Michael Storr, of course. Well, that's a story and a half. But Jay Vine, that almost matches him, what he's been, from winning a Swift Academy and coming on the World Tour, which is unheard of, anything like that happening, and then getting into a Grand Tour, and then just kept improving.
And got two more years on his contract.
Yeah, but his third place 2 days ago was staggering. And when he went down, like you and Macca, I thought he was out. I mean, he must have been doing 70K an hour when he's gone.
He might have had some sticky biddens, John.
But still,
you did right. It was a crap ride. Right.
I thought it was
no. But that, you take that element away from it. Yeah. The damage from those injuries to finish third, and look at the company he was keeping. So the one guy got away from him. Harada, who finished second, was doing a lot less work than Jay Vine was, and only just beat him. The guy who beat him has finished second at the Tour de France. He's finished third at the Tour de France, and he's won the King of the Mountains at the Tour de France in three stages there. So that's the guy who beat him. The guy who finished behind him just won the gold medal at the Olympic Games in mountain biking and is one of the big hopes for the sport and is an enormous talent. Jay Vine crashed at 60-plus Ks an hour and beat that guy, plus he beat a whole bunch of others in the breakaway. What a phenomenal performance. So
The way he came through and picked his way through the race, which was fragmenting, and he went boom, 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 up and got through. It was just amazing. It is amazing.
So Green Edge mascot. How does Green Edge miss signing a guy like this? How do they miss not having Michael Storer, who was with their development squad? How do they miss a guy like Ben O'Connor, who was out of contract at the end of last year? They'd be a little bit disappointed that they're missing some of these guys.
Well, if they listened to the mascot, they wouldn't have missed any of them. But anyway. Look,
Kevin Bartlett of Amble.
I was talking to Jerry about that the other day, and he realised that there has to be a big change in their thinking.
They need a scout. Look.
Those things, don't you worry. Jerry hasn't missed it. I can tell you that.
I haven't known Jerry to miss much, John.
No.
But cycling is no different to other sports. Like, in fact, it should be more emphasis on a specific role, like what you said, Kenan, like a scout.
Yeah.
Because it is getting so competitive and these young guys are coming on so much quicker, that role should be more defined and more priority.
The world has changed. The world has changed. Yes. You're not now chasing the big names anymore. You're chasing these youngsters who become big names very, very quickly. So,
which DSM have done brilliantly. And a guy like Matt White, his role as the DS, he shouldn't have to be the one that is trying to identify the young talent because he's in Europe. He's lived there for 20-plus years. It's not his responsibility, really, I wouldn't have thought, to know what's happening in the NRS. So, he can't be doing his DS role super well and doing that role super well. He needs somebody else to support him in identifying that young talent.
Yeah, for sure.
Infurious agreement, Matty.
So obviously, Adam Yates had a good ride, Matty, and I saw... what did he pull? 10 seconds or whatever went off the front
15,
there.
15, I think. Yeah.
I saw Bernal saying it was really good for team morale, but I read into that like... Well, what is the team morale at the moment? They're not used to having two grand tours back to back where they haven't really fired a shot and it hasn't quite worked. Where do you think they're at the moment?
Well, they've lost two. They've lost Carapaz and they lost Narváez. They're both abandoned. Narváez, it was through gastroenteritis, and Carapaz is just absolutely exhausted after what has been an enormous season for him. Bernal has been an interesting one. He hasn't been anywhere near them in the first week. And then there was the day that was won by Florian Seneschal, where he was the only guy from the GC that was able to stick with the Koenig Quickstep when they opened up the throttle. And that was the first time. It was just a glimmer of hope, I thought, for Bernal and for Ineos. And then the very next day, it was the first day in a mountaintop finish where he stayed with Mas, Roglic and Haig. I think that Bernal is improving, but in terms of what he needs to make up, he's currently 2:45 down on Roglic. So he's still got a lot of time to make up. And everybody's going to need a head start on Roglic before the individual time trial. But I think Roglic might be on a slight decline as well. He won the Olympic Games now more than 3 weeks ago, that individual time trial. You can only stay at that level for so long. Again, like you spoke about with Chloe in her interview, he's not a robot. He's only human. And he has in the past faded a little bit in the third week. And he wasn't responding really crisply just in the last couple of days to the attacks that we saw from Lopez, nor the move that we saw last night from Adam Yates. So I don't think it's a foregone conclusion yet that Roglic is going to win this thing.
No, and that's what Peter says. He says the Vuelta this year has been the best of the three Grand Tours this year. Do you agree, Matt?
Oh, mate, Pete, you and I are singing from the same hymn sheet. Absolutely. It's because there's that, there's less predictability about it, and that's what I really like. And I really, as much as Roglic is the big favourite, and I would not be in the least bit surprised if he does win, there's Movistar. They're not racing for the team's classification. They're all in with Lopez and Mas, and those two guys are actually combining really well together, much better than it looks like Valverde and Quintana ever worked together. Jack Haig is not out of this thing either. Jack Haig, you spoke about Matt Heyman as an example and how that's worked for Chloe. Jack Haig's exactly the same in this Vuelta after crashing out of the Tour. And he's in it fresh. He didn't go to the Olympics. He's a lot fresher than what Primoz Roglic was. And Jack's got a team around him that was built for the leader, Mikel Landa. I think Jack is looking absolutely fantastic. And we saw yesterday Jumbo-Visma for the first time use a tactic that we haven't seen them use before. They put Sepp Kuss in the early breakaway on the flat section before they hit the climbs even, when they were doing 52K an hour, and Movistar had to chase. So they're clearly thinking about what they need to do to protect Roglic and put other teams under pressure and expose them, force Movistar and Ineos to chase. So this race has got a lot to give yet.
Yeah, no, I agree. Well, I think stage 17 and 18 are monsters. They're both of them. And they're going to decide this bike race. The only thing I'm slightly disappointed in is that the last 2 days, which have been pretty serious climbing, that no one has really taken on attacked Jumbo-Visma. And I thought they would have done a bit more work. I mean, the fact that the Viking is still in the red jersey just shows that. There just hasn't been a lot of action. I thought they would have been working on him and doing some extra things. But anyway, we'll see.
Yeah. Well, the last climb yesterday wasn't quite hard enough. It was a 3.5% average gradient. Rafael Majka had been away solo for 87 kilometres and rode the big chain ring up there at 30-plus k an hour. So it's hard to get away under those circumstances. The day before, where I was expecting some attacks, Lopez went and he only took 5 seconds, I think it was. It was a headwind for the last 10 kilometres. But what Lopez said afterwards was the time gains were small, but I was pretty happy with how the legs felt. So he will keep attacking.
Well, here's a good question from Tom Maloney. Keenan, how many of the guys expecting the top 10 are misjudging the present leader and team?
That is a very good question. I think even Odd Christian Eiking might have misjudged how good he is. And this is a guy who is super relaxed, and that's part of his strength. And we saw how composed he was on the stage that was won by Romain Bardet. So he goes into that stage. He's got a 58-second lead ahead of Guillemartin. They've got 5 kilometres to go. Guillemartin attacks. Instead of responding to his nearest rival, he makes the quick assessment of, it's a headwind up here. He's got 5Ks to go. Jumbo-Visma are still looking after Roglic. They're going to have to chase at some stage. So I'll just stay on the wheel and out of the wind, and they'll eventually bring him back for me. What composure. And you'll love this, Dan. So when Odd Christian Eiking was riding for FDJ, he was 22 years of age, 2017, his second year with that squad. The second last day was up the Angliru, the most brutal climb in the Vuelta de España. And he finished 29th position on that stage. Pretty good. Ended his Vuelta fairly well. They transfer into Madrid that night. He goes out for a few beers and he gets back to the hotel. Team manager Mark Matteo sees him come into the hotel and figures, you're drunk. Says, you're not starting tomorrow. So he's done 20 stages, the last 100 kilometres ceremonial into Madrid. Matteo did not let him start that final stage. He then didn't renew his contract for the next year. Then 4 years later, he gets the leader's jersey as a 26-year-old at the Vuelta de España. He's on the podium, gets the red jersey. He goes backstage. He finishes the interview. First thing he does, he has a beer, posts a photo. I think I've earned it.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Get on it.
That is brilliant. There's a lesson in that, folks. Never deny yourself a froth.
I've lived by that. But
I don't think he can win it. Tom, I don't think he can win it, but he can. He's definitely going to finish top 10, I think, and maybe even top 5. He's going to be hard to dislodge.
Yeah. And it's a turning point in his career. He's getting the podium.
No, he's not going to get the podium, but maybe somewhere about 5th to 7th maybe. It's a turning point in his career.
Sam wants to know, what does Bike Exchange have to do to win a stage?
Stop walking under ladders or across black cats.
Look, Michael Matthews. Oh, Michael Matthews' last chance is today.
No, it's not Tuesday. It's a rest day, well, John.
The next
might be his last chance. Tuesday.
And you know, there's not really. I can tell you now that Fabio Jacobson is tired. He is struggling to get blown off the wheel, and I didn't like the way he cracked it with his teammate.
No, that was poor. Terrible.
Pretty poor. Pretty poor. Been hanging around Cav too long, I think. But so there is a chance. It's getting tough. Everyone's getting tired. So he's got a chance tomorrow night. That's his last chance. For Bike Exchange, they need to get someone in the breakaway in one of those.
Nick Schultz. They need Nick Schultz in the breakaway.
Nick's good. Nick is going well. And he was Nick's actually good. Very good the last day that Mike Storer won. Yeah. He looked very strong.
I think it's been a tough
crack yesterday.
Yeah, he's great, Mick Arnevi. And, you know, what's he doing next year? He's still up for contract. I think it's been a tough tour, John, for Lucas Hamilton. Actually, a tough season for Lucas Hamilton because he's seen all the guys of his generation. Michael Storer, for example, he first raced against him as a 13-year-old. He's now won two stages. Jai Hindley is the same age. The back end of last year, he finished second at the Giro and he won a stage. He's seen Ben O'Connor break out this year, again, a similar age. He won a stage at the Tour and he finished in fourth place overall. Jack Haig is having a brilliant performance here. So seeing all these guys around him of his generation that are having brilliant performances, and he's been the touted one for quite a while at the Bike Exchange team, and he hasn't had a year that's matched those guys, and not everybody progresses at the same time. And I think that is going to make it challenging for him just to deal with that, to put it aside, not get distracted by that, and continue to focus on his own path. And it was good to see him in the breakaway yesterday. I'd like to see him get a positive result throughout this Vuelta. Doesn't have to be a win, but something that sends him into the off season with a boost of morale heading into next year.
Got a couple of comments. Peter says, if you guys were right, well, this should be, if John was right, Bling would have won 10 stages by now.
Well played, Peter.
Benji, who's from the Lantime Rouge podcast, does some fantastic work. Without SBS coverage here in Belgium, this is one of the first times I've heard Matt Keenan. Clever man, this dude.
Well, Benji, it's all your fault. You have built the cult of Alex Aramburu. We've been on board, Benji.
Yeah, and Buster Thomas says, we are spoiled here in Australia with the excellence of SBS. We were talking to Macca, obviously, the other night, and, I think it is something to be recognised, the amount of legacy and work that the SBS coverage has done, you know, for cycling. And we were talking about even you're saying, you know, so far the Vuelta has been the best of the three Grand Tours. How good would it be if it got the same recognition and exposure and interest as the Tour de France? Because the racing's been fantastic.
Yeah, but the Tour is an event it's not a bike race, it's an event. So, it's a bit like the Spring Racing Carnival here in Australia. I pay zero attention to any horse race all year long, but all the paraphernalia that goes around the Spring Racing Carnival, I'll watch the Melbourne Cup. It's about the only horse race I watch each year. And I couldn't tell you who's won it previously, except for Jerry's horses when American has won. That's about it. Outside of that, and for a lot of people, the Tour de France is the same. And a lot of the feedback that we get in commentary is, I want to hear more about the chateaus and the churches. One of the best pieces of feedback I had was Stage 9 2018 that went to Roubaix. So you know the north of France. It's not the prettiest part of the world. The day was won by John Degenkolb. And I thought we had done a pretty good job in commentary. One of the pieces of feedback that I got was, you need to talk more about the chateaus. There's no chateaus in Roubaix. The place is run down. So we're going to start making them up.
Free Ranger says an interesting comment. No beers, but Chris Horner told the story on his channel how when he won the Vuelta, he ate Macca's every night.
He was also 103 years old when he won the Vuelta of Spain.
It was funny. Baden Cook was managing him around about that time, and he said his eating regime was absolutely terrible. It was Macca's, Kentucky. I mean, that's what
John,
he lived on.
It's calories in and calories out. He was getting plenty out the door. He needed to get them back in the door.
I guess so.
It was bonkers, that win. And then he did. And then after he could hardly get a contract at the end of that season. And he ended up at Lamprey, and then he didn't ride the Vuelta the following year. And so Lamprey got number one, and Valerio Conti, his first ever Grand Tour, Lamprey get number one, and then they just gave out their numbers alphabetically within that team. So Valerio Conte in his first Grand Tour, he's riding around with number one on his back. How's that?
Last one before we let you go. Maddie Samantha says, studies on COVID are still aren't conclusive on how it affects professional athletes. Bernal is surely still recovering. That's a good point.
Yeah. And I've been asking that question as well, and it varies for different people. And Magnus Cort Nielsen had COVID as well. Jens Kirkelaer, who you interview, he also had COVID. Harry Sweeney, he said he got a girlfriend as a result, so that was a pretty good outcome. It affects different people. Peter Sagan has had COVID. He hasn't looked the same. Fernando Gaviria has had COVID and hasn't looked the same. Egan Bernal, I'm not sure. He had it pretty much immediately after the Giro d'Italia, and it will have, at the very least, that will take away from his recovery from the Giro, which then pushes back his preparation for the Vuelta ever so slightly. And I don't think he's, you know, looking the Egan Bernal that won the Giro or the Egan Bernal that won the Tour a couple of years ago, but he is on the improve. I had a conversation with David McKenzie and Christophe Mallet a couple of days ago about Egan Bernal in comparison to Jonas Vingegaard. And if you're a team manager and you could sign only one of those guys, which one would you sign?
Jonas. I'd sign Jonas.
I said Jonas and they disagreed with me.
No, I'd sign Jonas.
Yeah. Stand your bloody ground.
He's the future. He's the future.
Well, let's go, John. Get the mascot on the phone to Jerry.
You know, there's COVID and there's COVID. This is what we're seeing. There are people who get COVID and end up in ICU, and there are people who get COVID and have virtually no symptoms. So
you sound like Donald Rumsfeld. There are known knowns. There are unknown knowns.
But it is the case, isn't it? I mean, you know, so that's why you know, someone can get it, hardly being affected. And look at poor Chloe. I mean, she ended up with in the sack around the heart with being inflamed. All of these different things can affect you. So,
Tom says, good point. Bernal,
good point, Bernal, Tom. And the long-term effects, the long-term effects, Tom, are also a big question.
Yeah. Hey, Matty, thanks for joining us on the detour, guys. Mate. Really appreciate it. Good luck for the final week of your commentary, mate. You're doing a stellar job with Macca, and we'll catch up again soon.
Thank you.
Enjoy the rest day, mate.
Will do.
Matt Keenan, commentator extraordinaire. Now, Iffy, we talk a lot about how to beat, you know, the routine of lockdowns and things like that. So one thing you always have to do, you always have to have a good laugh, and you always keep saying to me, bring back the Detour DeLorean, so it's back.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.
I don't care how many times you've seen this video. I said it to Sheriff the other night and someone did a supercut. It always makes me laugh. So here it is again. This is a supercut from the Vuelta in 2015, I think it was now. It's the Wear Frubie Best Of.
Green edge. What's the front?
Hey, Frumi.
Yo.
You see that video of his the other day?
Say again?
The video with him the other day, my passenger said, where's Frumi? I said, I don't know where Frumi is. Yeah, he did not like that story, did he?
He was thinking, get to the punchline, mate.
Yeah.
That was brilliant. He just wasted his time to tell him, how'd it go? Where's Frumi? Great story. You're so excited when you told him too.
Hey Frumi,
I've got a belter for you.
Hey.
The guy in the passenger seat asked where you were. He's awesome, mate. You think you look like lost it. Hey Frumi, we didn't finish the story.
I gotta ask the comments how we go to the punch.
We were just chewing the Frumi and we didn't finish the punchline. Can you get him to drop back?
Choo-choo! Frumi!
Chew him to Oryx Jetty's car, please. Neil needs to get the punchline out. The punchline was... My reply was, I don't give a f***. Possibly one of the worst stories you've shared with us.
Thank you.
Hang on, we got a story for you.
That's a story for you too, hang on, Dave.
I don't give a...
And then I said, you get it? It's funny, yeah?
Oh, crikey. What were you thinking?
Oh,
but you got the best reaction that you probably could have got. He smiled and rode off.
Yeah. Hey, g'day. What's going on? Hey?
Tell me a joke too.
Yeah. Hey, do you hear the one about? All my stories just finished there because
I heard that's how they all of them finished.
Hey, good day.
Good days. Good days. Never get dull. But now it's fantastic having Keenan on, and obviously Chloe. What a superstar. What a great media performer as well, Chloe is.
You know what? We don't have to do anything about our detour lockdown blues today, because just listen to Chloe. She nailed it.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
She nailed it.
And obviously we need to send a cheerio to Amilla Resorts. Have you got your script ready, Iffy?
I have.
Okay, I have. Perfect.
Yep. Discover a tropical playground of powdered sugar sand, lush jungle, and crystalline waters. Amilla Maldives Luxury Resort reeks of timeless style and endless bliss. Stand by for unexpected treats and indulgences. Delighting and surprising you is their hallmark. Amilla's motto is to exceed your expectations. The sky is the limit.
Ah, great stuff. Where are we at with the solid auctions? Anyone?
It hasn't jumped up. No, it's still 5,250. Although I haven't checked my emails the last hour, but at this stage, it's still 5,250.
Email John at cyclingevents.com.au. That's 5 nights for 2 adults, 2 children in a waterfront villa. That's breakfast, dinner, and Jason and the team will definitely look after you guys. Worth over $13,500. And the bid's at a bit over $5,000 at the moment. So it's an absolute steal. And obviously all the proceeds raised are going to go to the Koreka Foundation. All the money for the bid is going straight to those guys who are doing fantastic work with Phil Liggett. Anything you want to add before we wrap things up, Iffy? Tomorrow we're trying to get Jack Hay. We've put the sheriff onto it. We're going to try and do a pre-record interview. If we can't get Jack, we're definitely going to check in with some guys on the ground tomorrow, for sure.
So we would have got poor old Jack, but they didn't get until 11 o'clock last night, and the sheriff said he'll sleep right through till they have to get on the bike. So
that's right.
We missed getting him, but it'd be great to talk to him, because I reckon he's going to make the podium. I really do.
Oh, yeah. He's looking good, and particularly in this final week when it gets brutal, he's looking really good. Thanks again for all your support on the show, guys. YouTube.com/thedetourpodcast. We appreciate all the likes, shares, the subscriptions. It's really it makes a difference. It does. So the more we get, the more you get notified whenever we go live, and we'll be live again tomorrow, 6:30 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time. And we'll see you then for the final week of the Tour of Spain. Ciao.